sure the mic's
working. Can you use your mic, please? Put it on there. Use the mic, please.
Okay. Agenda item 7. This is a financial mess, and nothing in this report shows me how you're going to get out of it. We need to make massive savings quickly, but all I see in this report is inertia. From where I'm sitting, Barnet looks to be on the same trajectory as Northampton County. Decimated services and mass redundancies. Rather than spend my 2 minutes going through the reasons as to how you got to see this mess, I thought it'd be more constructive to give you my views on how you should try to address the problem. Put a ban on all new recruitment without CEO or Section 151 officer approval. It mentions in the report this as a possible option. It needs to be happening today, tomorrow. Force HR to come up with a clear plan of how they're going to cut vacancy costs back to 2010-11 levels. Review flash figures for payroll within 3 days of update and challenge any unbudgeted spending immediately. Take a leaf out of Northamptonshire's restructuring playbook for financial control and implement an independent procurement panel to review all expenditure over the green limit of, say, £10,000 and include within that capital special projects. You also need to get a much stronger grip on capital spending. If you can cut capital projects to balance the books now, then maybe you shouldn't have approved them in the first place. We negotiate the capital and lead contract, with the first target being the game share arrangement, which appears to be a license to print money, £23 million on procurement alone. The financial function is not delivering right now. You need a clear, joined up financial perspective with timely and accurate reporting. That's not what you're getting. The logical solution is to get that control of that, is to get it back in house quickly as possible. The Barnet Group has got a large duplicate management structure. You've got CEO, finance director, right down to a duplicate FOI department. 5 boards, 20 board directors. Management costs are £21 million, yet operating costs are half that. Looking at how you can rationalise Barnet Group structure and see if it can be restructured within Barnet Council could take out a large amount of duplicate admin function and a large amount of cost. Not only that, it would provide more integrated and efficient service for users. You duplicate many roles by having commissioning offices on 6 figure salaries that take capital, Cambridge education, etc., for senior management to implement them. This needs a radical overhaul, which I suspect will mean bringing more services back in house. This isn't about political dogma, it's about plain speaking common sense, something which has been absent in Barnet for a very long time.
Thank you.
I know, John, you've been doing this for some time, and you know, I'm agreeing on a lot of the stuff. Not everything that you propose, but a lot of the stuff. You said about strong grip on capital spend, and the other thing you mentioned was scrutiny.
Yeah.
It's been highlighted last week and since the elections. It says in some cases there's a 4 month gap between committees meeting. Do you think there should be far more regulars in running the committee system properly, that there should be far more meetings for councillors to actually ask the questions and make decisions?
I do. This committee is a really good example, because you don't need to get into October. Now, there's one of my supplementary questions. You know, they're talking about cash flows, and they aren't going to be presented until the October board meeting. But at the October meeting, you're going to be asked for permission to authorise borrowing. You can't make a decision, because you want to have the cash flows to understand what that borrowing should be. So, yeah, I think you're right. I think
just so that you can be immediately satisfied with something, I will be proposing that we try and fit in an extra July meeting.
Thank you.
Councillor Mitra.
Thank you, Chair. Mr. Dix, does it surprise you that there appears to have been a severe detrimental impact on the council's resources and finances in the last quarter? You regularly attend the former performance of contract management committee, which I used to sit on, and although things didn't look good during our last meeting in February. We've now seen, for example, the India deficit gone from 6 million to 13 million. Are you surprised that things seem to have gone so badly in the last few months?
I'll answer that in two ways. Am I surprised, having read the papers? Yes. Because if you, like, I look at policy resources, medium-term financial strategy, every PR committee, and they vary. So in February last year, it was no shortfall. In June last year, it was no shortfall. In November, it was a 6 million, then it dropped back to 5 point something million, suddenly it's 19 million. So from that point of view, yes, I am very surprised. However, I know going to the Courts of Contract Monitoring Committee meetings that I think you've got a fundamental problem with your management reporting. And it may well be that you as councillors aren't getting timely and accurate information quickly enough. But if I look back through the performance of contract monitoring, quarter four still hasn't been published. Now that's hopeless. So what you're doing is looking back on events that took place 5 months ago. You don't have a cat's chance in hell of being able to address that if it's something that happened 5 months ago. So in some ways I'm surprised. In other words, I'm not, because I think the financial reporting system is fundamentally broken. And it really worries me.
From what you've said, obviously, from reading the papers, my own first-hand experience as a councillor, would you agree that the current outsource financial reporting in the council is not fit for purpose? And that this what we see before us today demonstrates that is just not working. And also, you know, there is there's a democratic issue here in the sense that we went through local elections recently on the basis of the public thinking that the council's finances were under control, and quite clearly they're not under control. And it might well be something that I think the public are right to inform point of a practical local election. Because I think clearly the timing of this is such that I think the local election results make things very difficult.
Just one response. We're not actually suggesting that there should be a cessation of adult and children's social care in the last few weeks of a financial year, are you?
No, not at all. What I'm raising is the last thing I'm trying to is the fact that the knowledge of the dark position that we're in presented to this committee at this time, and actually a robust financial reporting system. My question then surely would have raised red flags far sooner.
Thank you.
Any
supplementary questions, Mr. Dix? To your...
Well, yeah, I'm not going to answer that question.
Yes, sir.
Because the issue is, you sat in this PR committee 6 weeks before financial year end, and you had no clue as to the problems. Now, you're right, things do change. Clearly, you know, there are significant demands on adult social and children's services. All that huge deficit didn't crop up in the 6 weeks before year end. You sit there and you take responsibility. You know, voters hold you accountable. But are you getting the information to make those decisions? And from what I'm saying, to answer Councillor Houston's question, is the financial system in place and working properly? The thing is, you've only got to look at all the issues we've had on financial reporting in the last 12 months, including last year's audit and the mess with that, to say it's not adequate. And I know there are investigations going on in the financial system at great expense, but it just doesn't seem to be adequate. I'm terrified that 5 years into this contract, it's still the same problem. And everybody says, we've got a problem. Nobody's addressing it. That's really my problem. In my speeches, it's all people say they're wrong. Get them and do something about it.
Thank you for your encouragement. Any questions? Any supplementary questions?
Sorry.
Just one on the property. What do you think actually happened? Because yes, you're right about committees, but also, A, there's the ability between committees, especially with modern technology, four councillors could be elected in four, that seems to be lacking. But also, presumably, these figures are monitored monthly internally. Reports presumably go, maybe not to committee. I don't know whether we'll need to get monthly reports, but those sort of things should happen. And given that a lot of the overspend we talk about there, well, in fact, some of these things are obviously reported. The praise is that we've held the number of children in care, yet you look at what it's more expensive. Those children are no matter, say, people, older people in residential homes, do not move into the homes on April the 1st. They do not move into the homes on January the 1st. So a lot of this is predictive, because as soon as you get the right, you know that that cost is going to go on for months. Do you think that that's also a problem, that they stick to, they don't update their reports in real time, which given new technology they can, and we can know what's going on between committees, rather than having to wait for reports that are 5 months old?
I spent the last 30 years going and helping companies, companies efficiently. And the first thing I always ask for is a management account. Where are you off your management accounts? What are the flash figures? I don't get a sense that that's distributed. Why? I don't know who gets them and where they go. But if they were getting those monthly management accounts and flash reporting, you'd see these issues. I don't know whether it doesn't exist or it's not being communicated, but there is a big problem. And in any business, you run a business. Councillor Cornelius, I'm sure you do monthly management accounts. I know I do. And I want to know exactly what I've spent in the last month. That seems to have gone missing.
Supplementary questions on the basis of the final question series.
It's a very simple question. We have quite a set of detailed financial papers today. In the light of your comments, do you think we should, as members, have confidence in what we put forward in Councillor Cornelius's names of the paper?
Sorry, Councillor Moore, are you suggesting that the officers will deliberately provide this?
No, I absolutely don't mean that, but it's...
Are you suggesting they will?
No, I'm trying to move my mind.
Well, I think you're...
No, I was not, but in the context of the challenges we've seen within this, and the fact that this appears to have crept up on us, I am genuinely concerned about what we're seeing before, what I've seen.
Can I answer your question? It's a good question, and what I would say is actually, I read this report, and for the first time I thought, hang on a minute, what's changed? Because actually, we are getting some decent quality information. I think we're actually getting a bit of straight talking. So actually, I was really encouraged by this report. I think the problem is, we haven't had that straight talking, clear reporting before. So, if anything, I would say, great, I thought the report was good, because actually it spells out in black and white the position we're in, very clearly. So, if that gives you some comfort.
It does. Thank you. Do you have any supplementary questions?
let me just check, because I don't want to reiterate stuff we've already done. Yeah, okay, right. So, supplementary to question one. In February and June, forecast shortfall for 2019-20, December 6.67, shortfall, February 5.96, suddenly 19.3. I think there is a problem with reporting systems. So my supplementary question is, will you, or the Section 151 officer, or whoever, set up an independent group to look into this problem with the financial reporting? Understand why it's arisen, and will you make the results of that investigation
public.
The answer is, sorry, I was just thinking that I was actually giving you the correct answer. The answer is that that is already being done, and that will be brought back in July.
And made public?
Yes.
My subject number two is the answer to the question, but by my reckoning, quite a significant proportion of the overspend seems to be on staffing costs. Certainly a significant chunk, either permanent or interim. Now, given that the connection of the bill is building real time, the HMRC require every employer now to comply with real time information. Why haven't you been receiving or reviewing weekly or monthly flash figures for the payroll costs?
Me personally?
Whoever is responsible for the finance, I suppose, sure it is. It is. It is.
Sorry, if I paraphrase the question, are the flash payroll figures monitored on a weekly or monthly basis to make sure that the person
I'm dressed. There's only a way you can produce it, but is somebody actually reviewing it with a view to say, well, hang on, we're overspent, what's going on?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Dix. So there is a monthly monitoring, and payroll forms a part of the monthly monitoring. At the moment, we are reviewing, as you heard from leadership, is that the way that monitoring information is interpreted and analysed. So there are some challenges around it.
So my summary to question three. Back in 2012, Councillor Dan Thomas recommended a 2.5% increase in council tax in 2013-14 and 2014-15. And he also thought that a freeze of council tax in 13-14 alone would cost £4 million. But he was persuaded by Councillor Brian Coleman that the council tax rates, by Bugle, did a great service for us, and it's there in the colour. I asked for a 10-year cost of a 1-year council tax freeze. The graph of doom showed the consequences of freezing council tax. So my question is, if you won't raise council tax above the forecast, which will result in a £42 million shortfall, is there a risk that, like Northamptonshire County Council, you may be forced, for example, to sell the new council office building to make up some of that shortfall?
Were we to sell an office building, that would be a capital receipt. It would not actually help the revenue position.
It would reduce borrowing.
It would reduce borrowing, which has a cost. Okay. Clearly, there's going to have to be a long, hard look at everything within the council.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So, the. Supplementary for question four, you knew this was coming. You know, Barnet forecasted in a graph of doom. You championed the graph of doom. But decisions were made to freeze council tax. Now, you say in here, you know, it's part of the government problem, government's fault. So my question to you is, given that the graph of doom was published back in 2012, over the last 6 years, how many meetings have you had with Barnet MPs to discuss this problem and get them to lobby government to change these strategies?
I'm not sure how many meetings that I've had, but they are in no doubt as to the views that I had regarding
this. No doubt. How much to be successful to change?
They are in no doubt about that.
Right, So my supplementary for question five is that's good. So what capital schemes are going to be cut and should you have embarked upon in the first place, given there's an awful lot of sunk costs that go into these projects before you lay a single brick?
I think we should have gone into them, but they will all be looked at.
But do we know which one is going to cut?
Not at this stage.
So, okay.
So my supplementary for question six is, for what it's worth, I'm with the current interim contract officer, but it doesn't address the issue of why a lower limit was agreed last year. Was the permanent section contract officer able to make an informed decision on balance levels if they had an inadequate financial diligence?
If the premise of your question is maintained, then clearly no, but since I don't accept the premise of your question, yes. She made the decision on the best information she had available at the time.
Okay. Well, that wasn't meant to blame her.
No, I accept that, but I was sorry, I just wanted to get in that I didn't necessarily accept the premise. But
I didn't want you talking to some stuff.
No.
So when you say this is new information since February, when were you told? Were you told in April or May?
Was I told in April or May?
So the increased overspend was as a result of work that's been closed down of financial accounts. That information was finalised in the weeks preceding the end of May. So it would have been as part of that process that we would have got to the final position. Mr. Barton might be able to expand a little bit on that once he has the section on that one, so having gone through that detail. But it would have been over that period. In closing the accounts last year, which happened up to the end of May.
So early May, we were getting to a clearer position.
So after the
election? Yeah.
Hurdle was unusually strict.
The report clearly states 1.4 for the additional borrowing cost is 9.7 million. You were saying that officers were preparing a report setting out cash flow to bring to the VNR, but the next thing is until October. And you need the cash flows today. You should have had that now. I take on board your point, because what I was going to say is we hold a VNR committee. Before it's done, you're saying, you said to me, well, I would be in July. Can we make sure that the cash flow is made available for that July meeting?
Will you provide an update? The final figures have been agreed to the summer, so will only be an update on the final position.
Okay. Are we going up paper?
So again, supplementary number, what is a financial target cost? Is it a final cost or a target cost? When will it be agreed and what is the risk that the ring-fenced business rates are insufficient to meet the borrowing costs?
There's a facility for the drawdown of those to be extended, so they will be sufficient.
So on the target cost, final cost, target cost?
Well, it's the final cost that will be the most significant thing, yes, on the final cost.
So that's one of the things that we negotiated with Network Rail at the moment, so I can confirm that the model is updated regularly and the business rates still comfortably cover the cost.
To the time, you can only you can manage it on so far, and that never appears to be breached. I recall sitting in a committee meeting back in November 2015, where this issue about managing demand was discussed, and officers were representing adults and children. So, both said, managing demand wasn't that simple. For example, when self-funding care happened, self-funding care and residents run out of money. And the rejoinder, I think, from Councillor Finn there was, well, try hard. The budget pressures and overspend advantages show that you can't try it, so it isn't time to come up with this difference.
I think one's got to work at it in a number of ways, and undoubtedly strategies change over the years. I mean, clearly something has to be done in order to use it as a control.
Right, so number 11. Please can you be a bit more specific about the what, when, and how, given each month's delay means less chance to implement a programme on time, and without the risk of a judicial review?
The usual process will take place. I mean, we do do that, and I know you're very good at responding to it, but the number of responses is often disappointing to be small.
I just wanted to know
when will that happen?
It'll kick off quite soon, early summer.
Is it incompetence or is it an untruth?
The one word I would say, feedback.